up, bro?
Aye.
There's not a rule that you have to use the three subs.
He's the best left back in Canada. We are the people we've been waiting for.
Howdy. That Cava kit, well, that Cava clip, sorry, is going to live rent-free in my memory. But hello, everyone. Welcome to the third sub-podcast live pre-game show for the Vancouver Whitecaps, presented by Macy's Sports. I'm your co-host, Alexandre Gangue-Ruzic, joined, as always, by Samuel Rowan. And we're back after a nice international break. We're back to the grind, the slog, the joy, whatever it is for you of club football. Lots to talk about. I mean, the Vancouver Whitecaps, a lot to get into after. It feels like you almost forgot about this team, really. I was checking the calendar today. It's been just under a month, just over 4 weeks since the Whitecaps last took the field. Lots to dive into with that. But, I mean, Sam, I mean, how are we doing today? It's been a while after the Canada game took a bit of a break, but we got so much to dive into today in terms of just the Vancouver Whitecaps and the big task that awaits them with the rest of this MLS season, that preseason 2.0, the part of the season 2.0 that all starts today against RSL Real Salt Lake, as mentioned in the banner there.
You laid it out perfectly. I mean, it feels weird to, there's been this second off season and we got used to Canada matches and now it's an adjustment. It's going to take a match for me to get back into the swing of things again. We also have the strange dynamic of, you know, home away from home. The same thing with Portland last year, right? Where there's this combination of, it's a home match for you, it's also a home match for the opponents. How does that work out? We had a combination press conference with the two coaches this week, right? Which was a strange dynamic. Both coaches acting kind of awkwardly. Didn't really get any good information because obviously they don't want to say anything in front of each other. I am looking forward to this one. I will preface that with, if we had more Canadian men's national team content, I'd probably sign up for that first. But we haven't brought it up yet. I can't believe you didn't mention it in your opener. Are we going to see the 3-5-2 tonight? Is that what's happening? Because we like formations on this show, and I don't know if it's going to go well, but I'm certainly excited to see it if it does happen.
Boy, and I mean, first of all, for Canada, thank goodness that I'm just looking at the schedule. In exactly a month's time, we'll have the women's team playing in the Olympics. I don't know yet.
Those matches are more exciting than the exhibition ones, because it would have been nice to see a goal or two for sure.
Who knows? We might have to fire up a pregame show for those. I mean, if any of you are up at 2 or 3 in the morning to listen to us do pregame shows for that. Obviously, the men's national team Gold Cup looks like they're going to bring all of their mercenaries to the Gold Cup. It's going to be a lot of fun to watch that. But in terms of the Whitecaps, you know, hopefully they can provide us a bit of entertainment before then, because just in terms of timing, the international break came at a perfect time if you happen to like both the Whitecaps and Canada soccer. Because the Whitecaps, 3 losses in a row, they weren't doing much offensively. They finally did score an open play goal, which feels, you know, crazy to even look back on the fact that was a thing. And it is still a thing, the Whitecaps' lack of chance creation. International break comes at a perfect time. It's a month off. You know, lots of Canada soccer. So for the Whitecaps, they're going to want to hit a clean slate. No better way to do that than the 3-5-2. Let's dive into that. I mean, the lineups aren't out as yet as per usual. It's MLS. We're back to wait and you know, 10, 15 minutes late for lineups after dealing with some teams that were dropping lineups 2, 3, 4 hours early before the game. So just shows you that we're certainly switching gears here. And then, as for the 3-5-2, it's something I outlined in my prediction or preview piece, sorry, for today. It makes sense for the Whitecaps on paper. They've got a lot of good central defenders. They've got some really talented fullbacks, like better than a lot of teams in MLS. Their midfielders are best deployed in a three-man midfield. You've got a lot of strikers. You don't have a lot of wingers. A 3-5-2 makes a lot of sense. But the problems with the 3-5-2 is that you work through the 3-5-2. It's a very hard formation to master tactically. You need some chance creation, and with no number 10, it's going to be a lot of chance creation burden on the fullbacks and Kyle Alexandre, assuming he starts kind of a little higher up the pitch ahead of, say, a Michael Baldissimo and Daniel Bakel underneath him. But on paper, there is a lot to like with the 3-5-2. But the question is, will the Whitecaps have trained it enough during this break? Will two friendlies against a USL League 2 team, you know, work? But I mean, the one advantage that the Whitecaps have had is that usually in international breaks, they do get decimated. But the only three names they had missing were obviously two of their best players, Cavallini and Adnan. But Patrick Metcalf did come back after a week away. So there's not the excuse of, oh, we didn't have our best guys to train together. Everyone was training together. So if they do play a 3-5-2, I'd hope it's coherent. Because there is, when you're looking at the framework, there's a lot to like with it.
Well, I guess you bring up, you know, quality fullbacks and fullback depth. I mean, that's one part of this team currently that's pretty decimated. You got Ali Adnan still in the international abyss that is trying to get a U.S. visa right now. Bruno Gaspar, I mean, that's a persistent knee thing that doesn't seem to be going away. He's not available. Jake Nowinski, we're probably going to find out shortly what his status actually is, because he was listed as day-to-day earlier this week. Obviously, injury news a little bit scant. You know, you don't know exactly what's going on. But, I mean, yeah, if you look at that depth chart on the right-hand side, as Ben's pulled up, I mean, that's, in theory, potentially your top two guys not available. Now, Javane Brown has really showed quite well in the opportunities he's had, and I'll be excited if we get to see more of him. But, you know, you just look at that overall depth chart, and you're basically picking the bottom guy on each side for what's potentially a very fullback-centric formation. So that's not a slight at all on Gutierrez or Brown. But if you're Mark Dos Santos, you're probably hoping that you have your two top choice fullbacks for that formation. And so I'm going to be interested to see what they play around with. And we're also probably at some point going to talk about the strikers and, you know, is Lucas Cavallini going to play tonight? Are we going to see Brian White, and how are they going to treat that up front?
Yeah, no, the fullbacks, credit to the Whitecaps for having enough good fullbacks that when you're arguably at the, I guess, fourth and fifth choice fullbacks on paper, and you're still doing okay. And Christian Gutierrez, who's a Canadian national team player who would have been in the camp this month had he not been dealing with an injury. And a guy like Javane Brown, who, you know, played fantastically in his first few games. He got put on the preliminary list for Jamaica at the Gold Cup, so he's clearly still in the Jamaica fold. That's a good team. You know, the Whitecaps do have good fullback depth, and it would be nice to say the day we'll see. You know, it's going to be one of those things. I hope it's not going to be like last year where it's like, when's the day we're going to see Christian Dahomey, David Milinkovic, Lucas Cavallini all on the field together, or the other one was Leonard Owusu, Daniel Bakel, and Michael Baldissimo. We never saw some of those trios, or we rarely did. So hopefully Ali Adnan and Bruno Gaspar, we do get to see a handful to a dozen games of them together in, say, a 3-5-2 or heck, even a 4-3-3 before the end of the year. But just the fact that with no Adnan, no Gaspar, you still have a Nowinski if he is fit or half fit, or Javane Brown, Christian Gutierrez. That's good fullback depth. You don't mind that. And I think that would be huge in a 3-5-2, just because in MLS, it's hard to play a 3-5-2, obviously, tactically, et cetera. But just because most teams don't have the fullbacks to play the 3-5-2, it's a formation that's very wing-back dependent. You need guys who can cover that field. I mean, if we're going to use Canada as an example, because we watched them play a 3-5-2 to decent success over the last few games of World Cup qualifiers, it helps immensely that they have a world-class fullback in Alphonso Davies, And then, and then you got a guy like Richie Larea or an Alistair Johnson on the other side. So for the Whitecaps, the fact that they have guys like Christian Gutierrez and Jermaine Brown today, but obviously Ali Adnan and Bruno Gaspar when they're back, is huge for a 3-5-2.
Yeah, I mean, that's to say that those guys are potentially at the bottom of the depth chart is pretty impressive, but you want that consistency match in, match out, right? And that's just with injuries, with whatever circumstances have surrounded this season, that's one of the elements that have made things really challenging. Is the lineup out? That looks like a face, like the lineup is out, and it looks like you don't like it. So
If anything, I like it. I'm just really surprised.
Oh,
so I guess first of all, we'll roll through it. I'm just processing. So you got Maxime Crepeau in goal. You got a back four of Javane Brown, Eric Godoy, Andy Rose, Christian Gutierrez, and then you got a 4-3-3 with everyone in their proper positions. I mean,
sign me up. Like
Michael Baldissimo, Janio Bikel, Kyle Alexandre midfield. Like, where did this come from? And then Christian Dahomey, Brian White, Daber Caicedo. I mean,
yeah.
Again, I personally, maybe Brian White goes out there and score. I would have liked to see Theo Bear starting up front. I mean, if you're going to bring Brian White in just to start him up top, like what is Theo Bear's purpose right now? But aside from that, I mean, there's a lot to like with that 4-3-3. Lucas Cavallini's on the bench. I think Godoy and Rose is probably the best cap center back pairing right now. You got Cornelius Bear. There's no Cameron Habibula on the bench, which is pretty interesting considering he just scored a bicycle kick last week in a friendly, as you saw in the intro video. But Leonard Owusu on the bench, Russell Tybert. Yeah, that looks like a surprisingly decent lineup, all things considered.
Well, biggest news of all, Russell Tybert has not been shoehorned into the lineup, which is something that hasn't happened for a long time. I mean, so I picked the Vancouver Whitecaps to lose 2-0. I'll preface, my comments by saying I still think they might lose this match, but I do like this lineup a lot more than maybe what I was expecting. I think White fits into that, center man in a 4-3-3 pretty well. We're going to obviously have to see what he can offer in a Whitecap shirt because all my exposure to him is with the Red Bulls. I do like the possibility for him to combine with the Colombians. Obviously, that midfield three, we've been waiting to see that in this kind of setup for a long time. Now, Baldissimo is listed as the defensive mid. I think him and Bikel are going to share defensive responsibilities. That'll probably be pretty fluid. And then, I'm excited about the opportunity for Javane Brown and Gutierrez to get forward. I guess my question is, what happens if Andy Rose and Eric Godoy get caught in space? That is the one thing where, Andy Rose, not the most fleet of foot. Eric Godoy is relatively mobile, but, he's coming back from injuries and more of a ball possession center back. I'm curious to see if RSL is able to get them in space, how does that play out? But overall, this is like an 8 or a 9 out of 10 lineup, I think, given the tools the Whitecaps had going into this one.
Yeah, no, it's nice to see a 4-3-3. I am a bit surprised we spent all this time talking about a 3-5-2. And
it's a smokescreen, all a smokescreen.
Apparently, but I'm trying to think. Was there any hints we missed with the 3-5-2? But I think, in all seriousness, I think the Whitecaps are going to have a 3-5-2, and it's good to have an emergency formation. You don't want to become too predictable, run things back every week. I mean, I guess there are some teams that can get away with it, but until you find a level of consistency where you're, blowing teams out every night, you are going to modify. But I think this 4-3-3 is a fantastic framework. I look at that midfield to start. I mean, the fact that it just boggles my mind. This is the first time that these three guys have started together because
absolutely crazy.
Collectively, they've all been so good. Like Michael Baldissimo's always looked fantastic. Kyle Alexandre, I mean, just his progressive positive play has been fantastic. And then a guy like Janio Bikel has quietly been so good for the Whitecaps. It just blows my mind that this is the first time we see all three of them starting together. It'd always be, Russell Tybert would be in there, or, Leonard Owusu didn't get a start, but, you know he would have figured in there. So I think this is good in terms of the midfield. The front three, I'm just happy to see Caicedo and Dahomey on the wings. I've been very impressed with what they've shown together. They're good wingers. It's good that the Caps have them. And again, yeah, the striker, I mean, hey, Brian White's always been a guy who's been good at getting on the end of crosses, end of passes, and finishing. So if this 4-3-3 does that, that's good news for Brian White. That's good news for Lucas Cavallini, who is pretty good at those skills. That's good for Theo Bear, who we talked about, who's also good at those skills. That's it. The Whitecaps' issue before this break was always chance creation. And I feel like for the first time this season with this 4-3-3, they've actually taken some tangible measures towards fixing that problem. If that, you know, I don't know if I'm the only one who feels that way, but it certainly looks like it for the first time. It's not, you're struggling to score open play goals. You're struggling to do this. Let's keep running back a 4-4-2 with, you know, a center mid playing left mid and a winger playing striker. It actually feels like there's some steps taken to address the problems, which is nice. It's nice to see for considering how, you know, important this game is, how important the upcoming games are for the Whitecaps.
Well, yeah, we spent a lot of time in written form on these pregame shows and podcast form talking about, you know, the improvements in certain areas, but the lack of final product. And maybe this is an opportunity to change that. And as you mentioned, someone who's been good at getting on the end of final product throughout his MLS career is Brian White. Not only his first appearance for the Whitecaps in a formal setting, in an MLS setting, but also his first start. And as you can see on the screen, you know, the fee, not an insubstantial fee of 400K. I mean, it is funny money, so, you know, you have to value that as you will, but did open his account in some senses in the friendlies that were played. I don't know if it's a USL League 2 team, so is it the highest level of competition out there? No, but still good to find the back of the net. And even in a bit of a down year, 5 goals and 18 appearances in 2020, a lot of people say that he kind of played his best football back in 2019 and that some of the coaching and other things surrounding the Red Bulls didn't really allow him to flourish the way some fans wanted. And I know a lot of New York Red Bulls fans were certainly sad to see him go, in some respects at least. And yeah, a really successful college career for Duke as well, which has a good collegiate program. And, you know, this one doesn't necessarily fit the Whitecaps recruiting mold as of lately, but I do think about all the way back to when we could actually speak with people in person at the training facility. And I remember talking with Mark DeSantos about what he felt his team was missing at the time. This is, you know, probably 2 years ago now. And he talked about players that understood the league, understood how to, you know, compete and contribute in MLS. And this fits the mold entirely, right? It's a depth striker who is super comfortable with the environment, super comfortable with the league, and isn't going to require any time to acclimatize. A lot of the players the Whitecaps have brought in require this big kind of bedding in period where they're getting used to living in North America. They're getting used to all these different things. White doesn't require any of that. He can just hit the ground running. Now, is the ceiling as high as some of the additions the Whitecaps have made? Probably not, but he's at probably 75-80% of his realized potential already, and you're going to get that right off the bat. So that's definitely a benefit for the Whitecaps and something they maybe haven't gotten a lot of in recent years.
Yeah, no, it's a good point about what White brings to the table. I think the experience is huge. I think, you know, just the fact that he knows the league. I mean, the question is always going to be, did you really need to go out and get a striker versus other positions?
But it's a different question entirely, right?
It is a different question entirely. But if you look at what White brings, there's always been a lot to like with his profile, a lot with what he's done for the New York Red Bulls. Certainly a good player, and I think that will show, say, tonight, you know, when he takes the field. I think he'll be good. I think in this 4-3-3, for example, it'll be good. It's just the questions arise. What happens when Cavallini's fit? Are you going to have White and Bear both on the bench? Is Bear going to go to the CPL? Because with the CPL starting up next week, which is, you know, feels wild to think that that's come up on us this fast here. And then, yeah, it's just going to be questions. Okay, what, you know, asset management, was this the right decision? What are you going to do in the future? Is White backing up? Is he going to start? Because he has the resume of a starter in MLS, and there are a few teams around the league who could have used him as a starter. So you wonder, okay, is coming to the Whitecaps to potentially ride the bench going to work? But hey, if it gets Lucas Cavallini more rest because Mark DeSantos trusts Brian White more than he does Theo Bear, as much as we'd like to get Theo Bear to play, at least getting Cavallini some rest would also be beneficial, because you know, running him into the ground is never going to be a formula that works. And I think the stats shown on the screen here show why. I mean, on Canada, he's been giving more of a secondary role, a role where obviously it helps. He's getting in the box and getting on the end of crosses like he's good at, instead of having to drop deep and play like a false nine, you know, number 10, whatever you want to call it. And with Vancouver, that's taking a toll on him. The minutes, the dropping deep, he's not getting in the box, he's not scoring, he's not generating chances, as shown by his XG, because even at least last year when he wasn't scoring, he was creating a lot of XG. So yeah, I think resting Cavallini, giving Cavallini what he needs to succeed is also a big priority. So if White helps him do that, then that also does help the move out of a fair bit.
Well, what I think of when I see this graphic is, you know, what role has Cava played for the national team? It's been that super sub off the bench, you know, go in and kind of clean up the scraps. And maybe he's got the opportunity to do that tonight. If the Whitecaps are going to win this one or get a good result, I could see Cava coming off the bench and having an impact performance. I mean, I think something that's, you know, you're not necessarily looking for a ton of assists from your strikers, but I look at that stat line and really even the one assist. I mean, it was a Ryan Raposo created turnover where all he had to do was just sort of play a ball across, and there wasn't a lot more to it than that. So he's, you know, there's not a big bottom line there in terms of chance creation if he's not scoring the goals himself, which is a well-advertised issue. And, you know, it wouldn't be a problem if you had the team to create chances, he just had to finish. But obviously it's been a bit of an issue so far this year. And you can see, you know, when you're Canada and you have play creators like Alphonso Davies and you know, the litany of guys they have in midfield like Marc-Anthony Kay, if you're Cavi, you don't have to worry about that at all. You just worry about, you know, getting basically right outside the 6-yard box and tapping it in with your left or right foot, which he's very, very good at. So as we're going to have to see how he's treated tonight and also how he's used going forward, especially if Brian White is a bigger part of the fold. But let's jump and talk a little bit RSL, because the lineup is out. And I don't think there's really a lot of surprises, but definitely a few players worth touching on in this one. So there we go. There we see the RSL lineup up on the screen. And for those that, you know, haven't watched a lot of RSL this year, they've got a good record, 3 draws in a row going into this one. Only 1 loss on the year, but it has to some extent been a bit of a mirage where they've really capitalized on a very high number of their goal scoring chances at a highly unsustainable rate. So the question is, you know, when do they come back down to earth, or are they able to kind of augment their playing style to, you know, create more high quality chances? Obviously you've got Rusnak and you've got Krylak, who can create a lot, and Krylak in particular has been really, really good so far this year. Rubio has been scoring. He's the ultimate offender when it comes to outperforming XG. But you know, they found a way to get results so far. Kind of it felt like the Whitecaps early in the year, where they were creating results even though maybe the play wasn't the best. RSL has been able to maintain that so far. I think it's an interesting matchup tonight. Obviously, you know, both teams kind of looking to get on a good starting track here. And I'm interested, Alex, what are your thoughts about this RSL lineup and anything that's really stood out to you from this team so far this year?
I'm surprised, but not surprised that among, like, just to show how consistent, I guess, RSL are in terms of their style, their game plan. Usually when you predict teams' lineups, I mean, I do it in my preview pieces, I'm usually about 3, 4, or 5 names off, because coaches love to rotate, love to mix things up. RSL's, you know, they've got
no surprises here.
I got 10 out of 11 in terms of the predicted lineup for RSL. The one question mark I had, I think is that right wing where Anderson Julio is. I thought Justin Merrim might claw in after, you know, the international break.
He hasn't been playing much though in a starting role. It's been mostly kind of super sub chance creation off the bench.
So I wasn't sure if he was going to start. The other one I did think was possible also going to start over Merrim and Julio was Michael Chang, who has had some really good games against the Whitecaps in the past. So obviously they want to go with Julio, but otherwise, pretty much as expected, Rubio Rubin, the very informed American striker who was scoring goals for fun before the international break. Well, I guess we'll see if the 3 weeks off did him any good or did him any bad. That's obviously an area to note. Demir Krylak, Albert Rusnak, two very talented players that can do damage to teams. You know, you look in that midfield, Ruiz, Beisler, very solid, very compact, very MLS-y midfield, I dare to say. It's very industrial. And then the back line, I mean, Justin Glad's been kicking around for a while. I think it's wild to think he was at Olympic qualifiers. He's still under the age of 24, which for how long he's been in MLS. Like,
well, I think he's 24 now, but still, it's one of those guys that you think he's going to be 30, and it's because he started so early when he was 16, 17, it feels like he's been in the league forever, right?
Exactly. He's been around for a while, and then Aaron Herrera at right back, for example. You know, it's some expected names, and the fun one in goal, obviously, is David Ochoa, the pot stirrer himself. He's been up to quite the adventure. I mean, the fact that it just blows my mind to think that he's what, 21? He was the starter for the U.S. at the Olympic qualifiers. Obviously, he had that one error that did cost the U.S. against Honduras. But otherwise, such a solid goalkeeper. And the fact that he was the third goalkeeper for the U.S. for them during Nations League. And Nations League and friendlies is credit to Ochoa. That's like that's pretty impressive for a 21-year-old goalkeeper behind Zach Steffen and Ethan Horvath, obviously the 1-2 for the U.S. He was the number three ahead of some other guys, like a Matt Turner, who's obviously been doing really good over at New England. And there are a few other American goalkeepers. So Ochoa is a very good player. When I've seen him for RSL, I mean, shout out if we're going to go all the way back to Ian Knighton.
I was gonna bring him up because he really put us on to David Ochoa.
Yeah, I think it was something in the 50s or so. At last year, we previewed RSL Whitecaps last year. We brought on Ian Knighton, RSL expert, covering over at RSL Soapbox, and he told us, we're like, who should we watch on RSL? He said, David Ochoa, fantastic young goalkeeper, has been doing great things for the Rail Monarchs. You know, obviously, you know, they were looking for guys in replacement of Nick Romando. You thought former Whitecaps goalkeeper Zach McMath was supposed to be that guy. I mean, the Whitecaps traded him there to be that guy. David Ochoa stepped out of the academy, has stepped up, and credit to him. So when I look at the lineup, he, for me, is really the centerpiece of the lineup. And I've kind of highlighted that here in our players to watch. Obviously, Rubio Rubin, the goals. And it's just not the goals, really. It's just his confidence. They're all nice goals. They're, you know, I think of a 20-yard dart along the ground in the corner. I think of an audacious bicycle kick. I think of, you know, just all these wild goals he's been scoring. It's just the form. Is that going to continue? Who knows? Maybe he's quiet this game after the break, but you certainly can't give him a half inch. And then obviously Justin Glad at the back is pretty key player, obviously playing for the US U23s. He's just a solid defender. But otherwise, I'd say watch out for Rusnak and Krylak, because they're creative. They always find a way to influence the game. And if the Whitecaps aren't careful, they could certainly have a bit of fun tonight.
Yeah, and I'd give an underrated shout to one guy who's not in that list, which is Pablo Ruiz, just 22 years old. He's been doing the job in central midfield for RSL so far this year. And when you look at goal creating and shot creating actions, you know, even from a deep lying role, he's been very involved up there with Krylak and Rusnak. So, you know, those are the two names you think of when it comes to RSL chance creation, but quietly Ruiz has been doing a really nice job as well. And that's a good young player for this RSL team.
Yeah, no, I think Pablo Ruiz is a very solid number six. Like you mentioned, you know, he seems like a very industrial guy. He is decent with the ball at his feet. I mean, it's he's a good piece. He's a key piece of Freddy Juarez's, you know, 4-2-3-1, along with a guy, you know, more of a veteran, like a guy like Beisler alongside him. I think that's a good shout. Ruiz, you know, in midfield holding things down, because the thing is with RSL, yeah, their identity kind of revolves around how solid they are defensively, that they have a good goalkeeper, a solid back four, two traditional holding mids. And if anything, you look at their lineup and there's a, you know, a little lacking offensively comparing to, say, you know, you're not looking at it and you're thinking this is going to be heavy metal soccer, but that's how they play. You know, they have a really solid foundation. And I think
it requires individual, I don't want to say brilliance, but it requires some of their best players to have really bright moments in order to create. Because if that doesn't happen, they don't necessarily have this free-flowing, fluid structure to just create a bunch of things naturally. And, you know, I guess someone like Michael Chang off the bench, he can kind of provide a bit of that spark, but they're not super, super deep. So that's, as you said, it's kind of, you know, it's structured football. They take their chances when they have the opportunity, but probably not going to see a, I mean, as much as Vancouver does line up in a 4-3-3, I don't feel like we're going to see a track meet in this one. Like, you know, Vancouver's going to try to take their chances, but neither of these teams is going to come just flying out of the gate.
Yeah. And I just looking at the stats before the game, I mean, both teams are quite defensively porous. Neither team creates too much. You know, no one holds possession. The Whitecaps do have a slight edge in possession. I think this is a good game if you're going to switch to this 4-3-3 to control possession a bit, play a little, at least show that you've got the foundations. I mean, if you're going to play a 4-3-3 with that midfield, they have the pieces to hold a bit of control, hold the ball, because as seen here, obviously very tight between the two teams. The Whitecaps obviously with 7 points, RSL with 9 points per game. You know, RSL does help by the fact they've only played 6 games to compared to the Whitecaps 7, because they had a bye week and they didn't play in the midweek. You know, in terms of expected goals per game, it's, you know, hasn't been too great from either side, among the lower teams in MLS with some of those lower numbers. So if you're the Whitecaps, I think this is a good game with all the formation change. You promised preseason 2.0. Well, I think against this RSL team will be a good test, because RSL will want to sit back a bit, kind of counter a bit more. Well, that's going to give you if you're the Whitecaps, that gives you a lot more possession, a lot more chances to break down what Salt Lake can do. And I think this is going to be a good test for Mark DeSantis's 4-3-3, because RSL, you know, even though they sit back deep, they're a solid team. They've given some good teams fits. They've beaten some good teams this year. So you can't take them easy by any stretch of the imagination. But if you're the Whitecaps, this certainly could, you know, lend yourself well to the kind of football they want to play. But if they end up playing how they did before the break, this could end up lending well to RSL. So it's going to be a very careful game of give and take.
Well, the one great equalizer against a structured team can be set pieces, right? I mean, it's the Whitecaps certainly profited off that earlier in the year. So maybe that's something they can do again, especially with Andy Rose and Eric Godoy at center back. You got Brian White up front, who can certainly head the ball. I think there are going to potentially be opportunities, especially if you play the way you kind of line things up, Alex, where the Whitecaps do control some of the possession. They try to, you know, take the game to RSL when they can. Maybe they can draw some fouls and create some opportunities in that sense. But do we want to move to a little bit of levity and a segment we haven't done in quite a while? But we've got some, you know, walk into the stadium photos from today. We have some fit checks, something we've been missing for quite a while. The Whitecaps away from home. I mean, this is, correct me if I'm wrong, Alex, this is still technically an away match for the Whitecaps.
Yep.
But it plays like a home match, obviously, or as close as they're going to get to a home match. So yeah, Alex, why don't you dive in and start us off here? What's the first thing that stands out to you?
Well, I'm just going to start and give a shout out to Max Crepo over on the right, rocking the orange shirt in support of Indigenous Peoples, First Nations, obviously, with some of the tragic discoveries that have continued, you know, that have been made and continue to have been made across the country. It's been, you know, it's been tough to hear and read some of the stories about, you know, the scar on Canada that is residential schools. But with June 21st coming up, which is National Indigenous Peoples Day, shout out to Max Crepo for rocking the orange shirt. He's always on top of, you know, just being a good voice for social justice issues. So I just want to shout out that. Elsewhere, there's some interesting summer fits. I mean, if you're going to go left to right, you got Ranko Veselinovic. We gave him a bit of flack the other time for rocking some very, you know, typical Eastern European looks. I mean, this is a little more North American.
This is a significant improvement. I'm much happier with this. I like the plaid pants. I like the sneakers are just kind of low key. It's just a clean, well put together fit. I'm pretty happy with it.
I mean, I don't know. I'm personally, like, if you're going to wear a nice dress shirt like that, I don't know. I think it's, I'd say maybe a 6 or 7. I think it's solid. I think there are some.
The bar was lowered after that first fit. So I think I'm giving them a step up, you know?
And then if we're going to go, you know what? Shout out to Javane Brown. I think that is right there. If I'm not mistaken, because the screen is quite small, for the Canadian tuxedo. Rocking the, you know, he wants to show that he is playing for a Canadian MLS team. Credit to him for rocking the Canadian tuxedo. I don't think it's something I could pull off, but I'm all for that. So I'll give him a little higher than Ranko. You know, Javane's fully gone into a specific fit. Ranko's kind of quartering on the side of, I kind of want to be formal, but I also want to go to the club after, you know, kind of one of those looks, you know, and then going across. Brian White with a very casual fit. I think it's a good fit. If we're talking about fits that you'd go clubbing with, he certainly has got that down pat. I think, you know, for pregame fits, I'm looking for a little more professionalism. So I drop a few marks that does look good. And then Derek Cornelius, Leonard Owusu, styling as always. The two guys always show up together, and they must do some sort of pregame coordination, because, you know, DC with a very nice shirt. I do like the you can tell the shirts well. Obviously, the rest pretty straightforward. And then same with the Owusu, a nice shirt, and the rest straightforward. I'd say overall, a decent day at the office for the Whitecaps, a 6 or 7 out of 10.
Yeah, I guess I'll add my takes. I mean, I like Javain's kind of flex on the Canadian tuxedo look. I think he's pulling it off pretty well. Brian White, it's a real New Jersey East Coast look. I'm kind of out on Yeezys at this point, so I feel like I got to deduct some marks there. But you know, hey, you do you. We're both rocking black shirts, just plain black shirts. So I guess that's all right. I mean, yeah, it's fine. I just don't think Yeezys constitute a fit in their own right. DC shirt is the best part of this whole thing.
It's
that's
phenomenal.
That's my favorite piece. And then shout out to Leo, who the last time we featured him, the tie was like halfway up his shirt. The pants didn't fit. It was just everything was a bit off, and he looks much more put together this time. So good on you, Leo. And then obviously, Max, you kind of said it already. It's a good cause and good to bring up awareness. So yes, exactly. Owusu gave up the tie. But I believe we also have some RSL fits. So why don't we just dive straight into
the enemies? Oh boy. Oh boy. I mean, I'm struggling to see who that is on the right there. Whoever's got that cropped white t-shirt.
That's Krylock, I think.
That is abysmal. That cropped shirt.
Zero out of 10.
That is the white on white with the I mean, the only thing nice that I can see is the watch. So, you know, credit to him. He's iced out on the, he's got some nice bling on his wrist, but that shirt, you wouldn't catch me. You know, if you ever see me wearing that thing, it's probably because, you know, I'm already in the ground buried 6 feet under, if I'm going to be honest. Not the greatest look there. Otherwise, I mean, Merrim, again, the classy, the 6 out of 10, the, you know, you're playing it safe.
A lot of guys in black shirts today, eh?
You know, playing it safe. And you just look, I think that's Justin Glad as well, playing it safe, kind of disappointing. Whoever's getting bunny-eared over there on the left side, also playing it safe. I, you know what? Poor from RSL, if I'm going to be honest. This is the home team. It's very basic.
Shout out producer Ben. I don't know how quick you can work, but there were a couple fits that aren't on this graphic from the RSL Instagram. There was one with a hat that was pretty good, and there was also kind of a very hype beast fit, and then it was not really my thing normally, but you know, he pulled it off really well. I think it was Rusnak. So producer Ben, if you can find those, maybe we'll jump back to them at some point. But yeah, certainly these guys, it's a lukewarm, mediocre 3 or 4 out of 10. And yeah, that the white on white look is just wow.
We had a howler. I've opened up the Instagram here. We got, I think this is Douglas Martinez, backup striker. He's rocking what appears to be a really nice fedora.
Jake Nerwinski style there.
Yeah, he's got a fedora, a black button up, some good pants. You got, who else is this here? You got Michael Chang with a really nice Derek Cornelius-esque shirt.
There were some better fits on the Instagram.
There was some good ones here. You got Rubio Rubin with a fantastic summer shirt. I mean, if you're looking, I mean, yeah, some of the guys we highlighted, maybe it was to make RSL look bad. But
anyways,
some...
we'll jump back to it if we get on it. But yeah, anyways, that's Whitecaps doing better than last time, because that was, other than toss, it was a bit rough. But Whitecaps kind of got their stuff together today. So I'm glad to see that. We'll have to see if it translates to play on the pitch. But
I mean, just to kind of hop off that, yeah, on that note, if you're looking to get iced up or get a good
what
fit
a check, segue. What a segue.
You know what? I know the place for you. If you got a car, if you got a bus, if you live in the neighborhood, head over to our friends over at Macy Sports. Very proud sponsors and partners with the show. I mean, first of all, if you're here and you somehow haven't entered in our giveaway yet, you can enter until later next week. So there's no rush. But if you want to get a bonus entry, if you predict the score for today's game, on either our Instagram or Twitter or both. We're not stopping you from entering multiple times on different platforms. You can win a pair of beautiful Adidas Cyclops limited edition X-Men boots that they look fantastic, yellow and blue. You look iced out on the field. You wear those over your shoulder. You look iced up showing up to the field. But otherwise, if you want to, say, as you see in the background, the Euros are coming up. I got my French kit behind me. If you want to, a little more modern version of this French kit I have, this one behind me is a bit of a relic. You can head over to Mace Sports and get the brand new French kit and brand new England kit, brand new all sorts of kits at Macy Sports. So shout out to them. Shout out to them for sponsoring the show.
Yeah. I hope this Vancouver Whitecaps match is a little bit more entertaining than, it wasn't terrible, but England, Scotland today, I was a little bit disappointed. I was looking for more, but,
it's not coming home. I don't think at the moment, is it?
No. I mean, shout out to Scotland for hanging in tough. I like to see that a lot, but, yeah, I was hoping for a bit better there. And yeah, I'm sure we could probably, especially the England men's national team, we could roast some of those fits pretty hard as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, they're fantastic kits to give.
No, but off the pitch.
No, I know. On the field, they look good. Off the field, you know what? You know, as long as you look good on the field, that's what matters. And there we go, producer Ben, pulling up with some of the one on the right there, that Michael, the Martinez hat. I think he wins the day on both teams. That's a niner. A 10 out of 10. So credit to that. But I mean, kind of speaking almost on that English subject of looking good on the field, we've got quite the kit matchup on our hands. If we're going to look at some of the kits on display, it's been a while since we've been watching a lot of Canada Red. We get to see a return of, I think it's the hoop for tonight. Obviously the wave is a backup and deployed up against those RSL Reds. It's going to be a very nice aesthetic kit matchup. And that's always nice to see on the other hand.
Yeah, I mean, RSL in the past has been lacking at times with their kits, despite having a really good color scheme. But they've come through recently. The subtle pattern in the background just, I think, really works on these colors for whatever reason. I know it shouldn't matter, but sometimes the sponsor does make a difference. And just having a sponsor that's plain lettering, I mean, it's not necessarily the best in the world, but it doesn't take away. And overall, I think even the integration of the Adidas stripes, you can do it in the right way or you can do it in the wrong way. And especially that red kit or the maroon or whatever you want to call it, I think they've done a really good job. And yeah, just it just kind of pops and all ties together pretty well. And it's going to be a top kit matchup today. I think sometimes we get some bad ones. Certainly certain MLS matchups aren't so great, but this is a good one tonight.
It's going to be a good one in terms of just aesthetics, but hopefully the game itself looks good, because if we're going to go shift over quickly to RSL, as we kind of touched on a bit earlier in terms of their offense, there are questions to be asked. Obviously, Rubio Rubin, everything he's touched has turned into gold, but otherwise it has been a quiet start for the RSL offense. They're not generating a whole lot of XG. They are finishing significantly above their XG. As seen there, 1.5 goals per game compared to 0.91 XG. So credit to Rubio Rubin for probably being at least a 70 or 80% the reason that is the case. 9 goals is, it's a good total, but it's a bit of a mirage. So I'm curious to see now against this Whitecaps team, what sort of RSL offense should we expect today? Do you think this is maybe a case of, okay, they could come down to earth in this game, or maybe is their offense a little better than the numbers might suggest? Might it be the other way around? Sorry.
Well, we have to consider that, Mark Dos Santos talked a lot about preseason 2.0, but it's been a preseason 2.0 for everyone else as well, right? Like, so the Vancouver Whitecaps aren't going to be the only team that has improved or found ways to correct things that were going wrong during the first 7-8 games of the season. It's worth noting RSL's only played 6 games as well. So it's a slow start to the year for them. They have even less sample size. So I don't see why RSL can't come out and create more. They certainly have, the star players for it at key positions. I think that just going with my gut here, I think that RSL is going to have a strong match. I think they're going to be able to create. And I, you know, that expected goals will eventually kind of come back down to earth. But I think that they have the players, you know, Ruben's in kind of a purple patch of form. You have Krylak playing really well. I don't think it's just going to immediately regress back to that expected goals. I think there's a good chance that they can, given their style of play, continue to sort of outperform what is expected. And against a Whitecaps team that's, for better or worse, been prone to individual errors or just slip-ups and otherwise kind of decent defending, I think that creates good opportunities for RSL to, you know, maybe bag a couple here.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll pose the question to you from a Whitecaps perspective. Do you think the last three games before the break, where they conceded two against Houston, three against SKC, and then, you know, another one against Minnesota, is more a true indication of the Whitecaps defense, or is the Montreal game where they kept a clean sheet, Portland where they kept a clean sheet, Colorado where they only kept them to a golazo of a free kick? Do you think those first few games are more reflective of the Whitecaps defense? We're going to talk about, you know, do you think, is it realistic to expect a clean sheet from the Whitecaps tonight, or do you think it's going to be a, you know, a bit of what we saw right before the international break?
Well, ultimate cop-out, but the truth lies somewhere in between, right? I think they were doing probably a slightly better job than Montreal. Had an off match. Portland didn't look very good. I don't know how much stock you can put in those. Even Colorado has certainly sort of figured it out since. Now that Luis Binks is going back to Europe, I'm going to adopt Sam Vines as one of my favorite players in MLS. And
yeah, that's true. Free Louis Binks.
Yeah, his impact has really been felt, I think, in Colorado. They've kind of found their stride. I don't want to – it's just – it's early season MLS, right? It's so hard to pin down exactly what's going on. My strategy is sort of going to be – until the Whitecaps prove that they can change the formation, create more chances, and still defend decently – I'm not gonna buy that stock until I see it in person. So for now, I'm gonna say that the last couple matches is probably more indicative. And then, you know, I'm happy to be proven wrong, but I need to see it first before I'm really gonna buy in. I need to see Eric Godoy stay healthy, because that hasn't been proven yet. And I need to see Andy Rose keep up his early season form. There's just so many question marks right now, and I can't do this over and over and over again with this Whitecaps team where I go, well, if everything works out perfectly, the Whitecaps can be good. And then I just get let down every time. So I'm going full cynic mode. And until I see it in person, I'm not going to buy it.
That's a good perspective. That's a good perspective. I think I'll take a bit of a more optimistic approach to the defense. I think I look at the lineup. I think Eric Godoy and Andy Rose, I think they played together, if I'm not mistaken, against Houston. Obviously, a bit of a tough night there. Obviously, the first goal itself, Max Crepo punched it. It made an uncharacteristic Max Crepo thing that we don't see too often from him. I think the other goal, some poor marking on the corner, a set piece. I think, you know what, looking at the defense, I think that there's a lot to like with an Eric Godoy and Andy Rose pairing. So I am expecting, say, maybe one or less goals today. I think against this RSL offense, I think we're going to see them a bit come down to earth. And I think the Whitecaps are going to defend well, but for anything, my question to both teams is who's going to score. I personally think if you're going to
predict the eternal question, right?
And I think we'll bring on producer Ben here, because we are nearing the end of our show here. But if I'm looking at my predictions, we haven't made ours yet. You're gonna have to write this down.
I made my prediction in the 86 Forever pregame, so it's on record. 2-0 RSL is my pick. But
you're gonna have to write mine down, because I have to do one officially, because we didn't do a preview show. You say in the traditional form. So I think if you're making predictions of this game, your base and your mind kind of starts at a 0-0 or a 1-1, and then you kind of go from there. It's not one where you're looking, you're like, yeah, 4-3 or a 3-2. Like this one, it's going to be a game of whoever scores the goal, whoever figures out the other team's defense. So to answer my own question, your earlier query, I think the Whitecaps will defend well this game. My issue is more, are they going to get any goals? But I guess on that note, should we go? We'll go around the horn and do predictions. Let's throw it over to producer Ben first of all. I mean, how are you doing today? And you know, good job, fantastic job, even I'd say as always on the graphics and the intro video.
No, well, thank you guys very much. Definitely weird to be back in blue and white and doing the show for the Whitecaps. And I see our viewer count as well, and definitely a lot less people across Canada tuning in to talk about the Vancouver Whitecaps.
What, the Whitecaps don't have national appeal? I can't believe it.
Well, we're a strong show in Vancouver, and there's lots of online shows in Vancouver as well. But yeah, beautiful day in Vancouver. I couldn't really ask for anything better than to be producing a nice show with the sun flowing in to where I am. But in terms of predictions, I'm insanely bad at these. I think if you look back through all of our shows, I don't think I've gotten one right or like even close, but we still do them. I'll go 2-1 for the Whitecaps. I think they do pull out a win at home, pseudo home, whatever you want to call it. But I do think that they'll find a win. If not, just because all the players are actually playing in their proper positions, and I can't remember the last time that actually happened.
It's interesting. It's interesting. I mean, Sam, over to you, since you've already got your prediction written down.
Yeah, I guess I don't know how much additional explanation. I just see, you know, Rubin in form. I see Krylak, who was just dominating for my fantasy team prior to the break. And I just think the Whitecaps toying with new formations. How many times have we been burned in the Mark DeSantis era? We looked at something on paper and gone, oh, yeah, I like that. That's going to be good. And then, you know, 25 minutes in, it's like, oh no, this match just needs to end as soon as possible. So I don't know. I'm going to reiterate what I said before. Until I kind of see proof that something's changed, I'm not going to just throw blind faith into it. And pretty much everyone on Age Six Forever predicted a Whitecaps win. So I'm also doing the sports betting thing of kind of like hedging, in the sense that if they all get it right, they aren't really gaining points against each other. But if I get it right, I'm going to gain points against all of them. So it's a bit of a strategic thing as well.
That's interesting. That's interesting. Well, I'm going to, you know, kind of pivot on a different one. I'm going.
You going for the draw? You going for the draw?
No. I am going for, I'll go a 2-0 Whitecaps win. And I have my reasons for this.
Be a little positive here, I see.
I have reasons for this. Nothing to do with positivity or blind optimism or whatever. The Whitecaps did the double over RSL last year. RSL, aside from maybe a Rubio Rubin and, you know, maybe one or two changes otherwise, they're mostly the same team coached by the, you know, the same guy. And I really like Freddie Juarez. I like RSL. I just think for whatever reason, the Whitecaps matched up well against them last year. And you look at the Whitecaps roster, they've got significantly better talent-wise. I think this is the kind of game the Whitecaps win 2-0. Just the way they match up with RSL is very favorable. I think the Whitecaps defense will, you know, after the international break, you got arrested Max Crepeau, you got, you know, your two arguably first choice center backs. I think they can keep do the work defensively, and then I have no idea where the goals are going to come for. Maybe, you know, a Brian White goal just to, you know, for to pure irony after all the people questioning a trade like that. I feel like that would be so typical if Brian White scored and then the other goal, I don't know, maybe a Kyle Alexandre first goal in MLS or something. So I see a path towards a 2-0, but it's mostly based on the fact that what I saw last year and just how things are trending.
Are those Brian both White, from Brian open play, Alex?
Whitecaps game he's played in.
That's true.
He played the two games against Ogden and he scored two goals. I think he has three goals in two games for the Whitecaps so far against a USL2 team. So there's something there, right? But who knows whether that translates to actually playing against an MLS team.
I mean, hey, Lucas Cavallini is also the king of exhibition games in the Whitecaps turn. We've seen how his play is his goal scoring has translated from exhibition to regular season. To answer your question, Sam, I'll go 1 in open play. I think they'll score another one in open play, but I think the other one has to be a corner, or it has to be like a free kick or something like that. I don't know how that's going to work, because I don't know. Kyle doesn't take free kicks, so maybe he's the one scoring the header and Cavallini, or I don't know, something along the lines of that. But I think it's going to be one set piece, one open play.
Well, okay, so something I'm thinking of here, something we did for Canada, wacky predictions. Do we want to go there? I feel like there's more fun to be had. Wacky predictions for Canada is a little less... It feels like you have a better sense for things, but wacky predictions for the Whitecaps. I mean, how deep on the bench are we going for this? What can you think of? And maybe Ben will throw it to you first. Because I liked, even though it didn't happen, I really liked your wacky prediction for the Canada-Haiti.
I mean, we know me. I will always pick the tie that's going to score a goal as my wacky prediction. I don't think that's going to happen tonight in reality, and that's a little too wacky for even a wacky prediction. But I think Brian White's going to score on his debut. I think it's going to be a good goal as well. I'll say out of the box from Brian White, which is very uncharacteristic for him because he's another player like Cavallini who can only finish within 8 yards in the net. But he's going to have a be feeling it tonight. Take a shot from 20 yards out, and it's going to beat Ochoa. So I think that Brian White will score, and it's going to be a very nice one.
Boy, I mean, the thing is, my wacky prediction doesn't line up with my actual prediction, but I'm kind of here for the chaos. I'll go Brian White brace just so he can pass Lucas Cavallini in terms of goals for the Whitecaps this season. I just feel like that would be so – something about that would be hilarious for him to score a brace and already pass his supposed, you know, starting man he's the backup to in just one game. There'd be something – hilarious about Brian White scoring a brace. So I'll have that as my wacky prediction, even though it didn't maybe line up with what I predicted a few moments ago.
Okay, so here's mine, and this is going in line with Mark Dos Santos's, you know, renewed attitude where he's all of a sudden he's decided that, you know, hey, I'm gonna play every player at the normal position. I'm going to, you know, just change my strategy. And I think that's going to mean that Cam Habibula comes on before the 60th minute. So Mark Dos Santos traditionally has not liked
making. I'm going to have to burst your bubble on this one, Sam. He's not on the bench.
What? I thought I didn't have to check that. Is he injured? Why isn't he on the bench?
Him and Jake Nowinski aren't on the bench. I'll just double
that's,
check.
That's traumatizing. I thought after the Patrick bicycle Metcalf, kick.
Ryan Raposo, Theo Bear could all fit your mold there, but unfortunately Cameron Abiwila is not among those on the bench.
That's disappointing. I don't have a lot of confidence in any of those other guys to come off the bench early. But hey, maybe Pat Metcalf, because it's a three-man midfield, Baldy and Bakel kind of fit in the Metcalf mold. Let's say that Pat comes off the bench and has a good showing, especially coming off, you know, maybe Herdman was giving good reports from the camp, but that's really disappointing. I hope that Cam's doing all right physically, and that's just a rest or maintenance type of thing, or it's not too serious at least. Because I felt like Cam was sort of building momentum, and Mark Dos Santos seemed to be trusting him more and more. So if that's not a shout for this match, hopefully it's a shout midweek because you know, it's right around the corner. So hopefully he's fit by then and can figure in some respect at least.
I was also sort of hoping that we would see Habibula maybe even in the starting lineup after scoring that bicycle kick that went semi-viral in Vancouver Whitecaps world. But the Whitecaps were wearing the Parley jersey that game, which I found very interesting because all of the MLS teams were wearing their Parley kits the weekend before. The Whitecaps had a bye, and then the only game that they actually got to play in the promotional kits was a friendly against the USL2 team. But Cameron Habibula at least made it, so a lot of people saw that goal. But one of the other things that I did want to bring up is a bit of a new look in MLS. Chicago Fire, they're getting a new logo finally, because that one in the middle there, I think we can all agree, is pretty disastrous. I think they really should have stuck with the original one, the Fire Shield. I think that looked good. But I guess I'll throw it to one of you guys for your thoughts on the new one.
Boy, I mean, I don't know. I'm not from Chicago, so I don't understand the significance of everything. You know, apparently that star is part of the Chicago flag, for example. I'd say the logo is meh. In my opinion, it looks okay. Kind of looks like a baseball logo. Fantastic color scheme, though. My goodness. Red with those light blue and white accents on a kit would be fantastic. They are looking to go back to red kits in 2023. It's been reported. So you know what? I'll give them a 6 out of 10. Probably should have been something similar to this in the first go around. It probably shouldn't have taken mass outrage because, again, like we've said many times before, you should consult with your fans beforehand to avoid this sort of outrage. But credit to them for getting it right eventually. Some teams would have been stubborn and would have dodged that completely. And at least here, they're going back to something that's a little more Chicago, a little more iconic. And it matches the Chicago Red Stars kit, actually, and colors, which is interesting because I felt like they've had some of the best kits in the NWSL. So maybe a bit of universal, you know, kits across both teams could be a way to drum up interest in both teams, because I feel like with these colors, they could have some fire looks.
Yeah, I mean, so this is a tough one because normally I'm totally in favor of the wacky MLS names for teams like you know, Columbus Crew trying to go away, not a fan of that, you know, and other kind of washing of the traditional MLS names. But this is one where I just think it sucks that when you Google Chicago Fire, everything you get is about the TV show, and you have to scroll down to like the fifth or sixth result before you get anything about the actual team. And I think that's really challenging to overcome. Like the fact that I have to, that and the fact that when you search MLS, you get like the realtor website first, and you have to search MLS soccer.
Major listing service,
like
baby.
Top list of just pet peeves in terms of North American soccer. Those are two things right at the top of the list. In terms of the logo itself, I mean, this is just kind of, this is, you know, slapping that duct tape on the gaping hole in the boat, right? They rebranded. Also, the team hasn't been good since they've rebranded. They definitely made some good moves, but they just, it hasn't really, the play hasn't matched it. So I guess I like the fact that they're going to refresh the refresh and hopefully maybe have some better results. But yeah, it's okay. I want to reserve judgment until I see kits, because the color scheme, I'm a big fan of the light blue, and I think there's a lot they can do with that. So the logo doesn't blow me away. I think the kits have a chance to be special, but yeah, Chicago Fire, as much as I like the team name, I just think, yeah, if a mediocre TV show has more notoriety than your team name, that's a tough look.
Yeah, no, it really is. But I guess on that note, we're going to go over to the Whitecaps game. Obviously, as we've joked around in the past, classic MLS, it's 7:01. We're still about 6-7 minutes away from kickoff. At this time, we'd be eating into a Canada game, or if you're watching the Euros or Copa America, our long would have started already. So shout out to MLS for MLSing. But on that note, that was another edition of the third sub-podcast, live pregame show presented by Macy Sports. Shout out to producer Ben. Shout out to Sam. I'm your co-host, Alexandre Gangue-Ruzic. And we'll catch you next time with more episodes and also our next live show, which comes to us soon, Wednesday. The Whitecaps play a rare midweek game against the Galaxy. The first game against the Galaxy. The new look Galaxy. The Galaxy's looking pretty darn good, actually. So that's going to be one heck of a matchup. Hopefully this one can entertain, but we'll see you next time.
What's up, bro?
Aye.
There's not a rule that you have to use the three subs.
He's the best left back in Canada.